I'm doing, this is my new favorite response. One of my good friends taught me, I'm quarantine good, which is about as good as you can be for being in, still in quarantine. I think those answers to both of those questions go hand in hand. Like, I think, how is it different? It's way different solely because I'm telling my story in the truest possible way I have so far. And that's kind of also what the album is me telling my story, who I am, what I've been through, what's led up to me at 23 years old, which is when I wrote the songs, and how that's made me who I am, i.e. my gospel, which is why I called it the gospel at 23. So each song, it's not really like, this is what happened when I was 15, and this is what happened when I was 16. It's more so like little bits and pieces. So it'll be anything from a certain lyric, like in Old AF, it's like, being young's pretty easy to forget when you're 16 and 18 years old and 19 years old. But then there's also songs that have no real time frame, no real like setting to them. Like Without You is an ever-changing relationship with my faith, you know? So. It's not as much each song is about a specific like part of my life, but it's more so if you listen to the whole album, by the end of it, you should have a pretty good grasp of who I am. My favorite song from the album changes all the time. And I love each of them, you know, that's like my kids, I guess. It's like, you can't tell me, and I don't have kids. I don't know if that's, I need to clarify that. But if I did have kids, I'd imagine it's like my songs. Which is, I feel like some days I wake up and all I want to listen to is Happy Ending, or some days I wake up and all I want to listen to is Rolling Rain because I'm feeling a little bit more dark. But each song had a real story behind not only what the song's about, but how it came about. I remember writing Rolling Rain and I did not want to work that day. I felt dark and I felt like I didn't have anything else to say. I didn't really have anything else to talk about. And my co-writers and everybody around me was like, that's what we gotta write about. We gotta write about the dark moments, the moments where you don't feel like anything, where you feel like dirt, which is why we came up with that lyric. Rolling rain falls to the earth and it turns me to dirt. And so each song's got its own little quirk about it that makes me love it. But some days I wake up, today, it's Sunday. So I'm gonna go with Love People because it's kind of like my worship, my self-love. Kind of feel good song. The creative process for me in songwriting specifically is a little bit all over the place in terms of sometimes I have a melody, sometimes I have a chord progression, sometimes I have the subject matter on which I want to talk about, sometimes I just have like one line. Like I remember when we were writing Happy Ending, before we wrote the rest of it, the only line that came into my mind was, all my skeletons hopped out the closet and they're dancing with my sisters to the cha-cha slide. And I don't know why, like, I just loved that. Like, I was like, oh, it'd be cool if, like, because I have skeletons in my closet, but now because I talked about everything, I can, they're out and they're chilling with my sisters. And then I was thinking, like, oh, it's funny if they were all, like, doing a dance together. And so, like, it varies throughout the whole process. But for this album, other than that song, Happy Ending, a lot of them came from, hey, I need to write a song now that is the perfect alarm clock, because a lot of the times when I wake up in the morning, I need something to tell me to stay motivated, to chase after something today, to get up and go and work out, or get up and go and get some work done. And that's what ended up being Good Morning. And so for the creative process of the album, we definitely took a lot of, it definitely was, what do we want to write about today? And that's where most of the songs came from. Music definitely runs in my family, and not even just like, obviously my mom and my dad grew up, they raised us to love music, and we're such big music connoisseurs, and my sisters all sing, and there's nothing that I love more than singing with my sisters. But even if you take it to the extended family, my cousins, I have insanely talented family members that are not in the music industry, and they just love singing with the family and having, you know, making memories together through music. I don't think I've ever done one specifically like, yo, I want to make a video, but you can definitely search up Iono Family on YouTube or something, and I bet you you'll find a video of us singing somewhere. I like to think of YouTube, as I look back at YouTube, because I've been now on YouTube for 8 years, and as I look back at it, YouTube really kind of like tricked me into learning a lot of things that I didn't even realize I had learned. You know, I learned production by making mashups. Like if you go back to my earliest mashup, it was simply like, and then now like if you listen to my mashups, there's full productions going on. You have strings, you have synths, you have samples, you have so many different things. And so that's only one piece of how social media, not only we can look at it on the surface. Social media was an incredible platform that I've been able to build a fan base on, connect with human beings, tell my story, have people join me in my journey. I think that answer is given. So I've been recently diving deeper into how social media really has changed me. And one of the biggest ways it's changed me is by teaching me so many skills and so many lessons just by posting on it that I didn't even realize I've learned, from production to video editing, even to learning how to, you know, stand for what I believe in and learning about what's going on in the world and really helping me shape my opinions and my views on how I think the world should be its most successful version of itself. You know, it's something like I remember when I was starting my YouTube channel, and I don't, it's not even to call out anybody else, but I do remember like reaching out to big names and being like, can I work with you? Let me know, like I would love to, and very rarely hearing back. And so I always had that chip on my shoulder of, you know, whenever I make it, which, you know, whenever I get millions of subscribers, or whatever, I'm always gonna turn around and help everybody. And so Tuesday Rising is honestly just my way of expressing that this is how it should be. That when you lift other people, you also are lifting yourself. When you lift other people, you're also showing who you are as a person. And I just want everybody to know who I am as a person in all things that I do.
That's really amazing.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you very much. I mean, musically, obviously with the gospel at 23, I just went into my dark closet of stories and weaknesses and the things that keep me up at night, and I wrote about that. But, you know, I get inspired every day. I look at influencers on TikTok right now that are creating movies in their bedroom and building massive amounts of fans from their tiny bedroom. And I've always loved that because it proves that the same way that I did on YouTube, like building a fan base, I was in my parents', you know, I was living with my parents in our one bedroom apartment, making YouTube videos in the living room. It doesn't, I think that's what inspires me a lot is that continuous message that it does not matter where you come from. It does not matter where you're starting. It doesn't matter how many people you know in the industry or how many connections you have or how much money your parents have. I'm constantly inspired by the people who have maybe none of those things or just one of those things or maybe two of those things, and don't let that limit them at all. If anything, they make it their reason to be better. And so I'm always inspired to wake up every morning, wake up early, because I know that there's somebody who is out there who might have more or less of an advantage of me and is gonna be working their ass off. So I gotta get out and do mine too. The highs and the lows that I've experienced through my career so far. I think honestly, a lot of the highs are from, you know, both, I think the answer is expectations. A lot of my highs are from when I remember setting my expectations so low. You know, from, I remember I did this concert on Hollywood Boulevard. It was a pop-up shop where I was selling a piece of merch and performing a few songs. And I remember being like, nobody's gonna show up. Like, nobody cares about me. And then I pull up and there's 500 people wrapped around the building. Building's hitting capacity. I ended up doing two performances. that was one of the highs for me because I had set my expectations so low. And I think the vice versa, you know, I remember putting up videos thinking to myself, oh man, this video is gonna go crazy. This video is gonna get millions of views. And then it doesn't. And I remember those trigger definitely lower points for me. And I think in terms of setting my expectations, that's something that I've been working a lot on recently, is making sure that it's not about thinking everything's gonna be terrible. But for me, when I think about what gives me the high and what gives me the low, it's often because I set my expectations a certain way and I'm wrong with that expectation. And so in terms of the highs and the lows, like the highs are definitely moments in which I didn't think something was gonna go crazy. My one dance mashup obviously is a massive high for me because I put it up and I was like, oh, just another YouTube video. Here we go. And then that one ended up being, you know, getting 50 to 60, 70, I don't even know how many millions of views it has now. Same with I Spy video. Lows can definitely be moments in which I had my expectations that I really wanted something to go a certain way and it just didn't. You know what it is like, I remember when I first started my YouTube channel and I was just excited or lucky or grateful, or it was a high for me to get 100 views. And I think the issue is what happens is we live in this world of more, 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 that the more views you get, the more followers you get, the more that you expect. Where in reality, if you just keep your expectations that I'm just lucky that I'm a dude who gets to make music and post on social media and spend time with his family and I get to tell my story, that's enough. The issue is once your expectations exceed that and you go, well, I want to do that, but I also want millions of dollars and this and that. Those are all byproducts. You can't expect those things. And that's what I'm starting to learn, is learning what I am allowed or what I should allow myself to expect, and learning what I should allow myself to just be grateful for if it happens. Ah. Relevant. I hate that word. I'm not gonna lie. What is relevant? Like, I remember having that talking about lows, highs and lows. Like, I remember when my mashups started getting less views than they did before, and you start thinking like, I'm irrelevant. And like, who says that? Who's like the relevant governor? You know what I mean? Like, who's the guy or girl or person who says, hey, you're relevant, you're not relevant, you're this, you're that? Because at the end of the day, we all decide ourselves who's relevant. Like, I think I'm relevant as hell, you know? I think I'm super relevant. And I keep my relevance because I know that I wake up and my family loves me, my friends love me. So adapting to me and staying, like, I kick out staying relevant because I'm like, I'm gonna do what I love to do. And if you set those expectations, like I said, then you're gonna just disappoint yourself. But the way that I adapt to the ever-changing, like, media, which is today's industry, is by, like, watching it, being a fan. Like, I watch hella TikToks, I watch hella YouTube videos and Instagram. And I just see what I like. Like, if I see somebody who's doing a certain kind of video and I'm like, oh, I like that, I just give it a try. And if it works, dope. And if it doesn't work, then I just like keep trying. But the idea, I think it's really actually quite a an ankle weight, if you will, by saying like, I need to post so that I'm relevant. I need to post so that I'm this. It's like, I just focus on connecting with people and making sure that I'm keeping up with the times more than trying to be like super relevant. Cause I know people who are like that, who just try and do whatever is the most popping thing at the time. And it's just like cringy to me. It's just kind of like, I don't know. I want to do what speaks to me more than anything. And sometimes what is relevant is what does speak to me. That's the most important. That's how you become relevant, is by being happy. Happiness is relevance to me. My advice. What is my advice? My advice is kind of like what if you look at the world right now, you look at, you know, look at Charlie D'Amelio, look at, you know, the Addison Rays, look at these influencers, this newer wave of influencers are so popping, and they make videos in their bedroom. Like, that's my advice to you is don't, there's no excuse. Take the excuses out of everything. Like, there is no excuse for why you don't have a certain amount of views. There's no excuse for, oh, well, if I had this, then I could be that. Like, cause TikTokers are making videos in their bedroom. And I was making YouTube videos in my bedroom with a borrowed microphone and my dad's computer. You know, it's like, there really is, I think you gotta just look at what you actually have. Don't focus on the things that you don't have or you would be better if you do have, but look at the stuff that you have, make the most out of that stuff and just work your ass off. Like, to me, that's just, and I still do that. I consistently, I wake up and I look at my team and I look at what I have around me and I say, okay, what do I have? How do we make this work? Like, I'm gonna like debunk the whole like fashion thing. Like, these are all a bunch of clothes I actually just own already. And because of the pandemic, like, we're doing photo shoots with the clothes that I've probably already shot in hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times, but I'm just gonna like switch up the combinations of the outfits and I'm gonna work with what I have instead of saying like, oh, well, I can't do a shoot because this store is not open or that brand's not shipping anymore. So I think doing those two things and then outworking everybody all the time, no one will ever be able to beat a hard worker. You can't beat a hard worker. The most talented person in the room won't be able to beat a hard worker unless they work as hard as them. Ooh! If I was a book, what book would I be and why? Is this like, what book do I think is who I am, or what book do I think like I would want to be?
It's an open question. It could be any of those.
If I was a book, what book would I be? I would be The Alchemist. And I would be The Alchemist because that book is, I think, one of the most, and not because I think I am the character in The Alchemist, but The Alchemist is such a overarching story of what a journey really is and a quest really is. When you quest for something and the universe conspires around you to achieve that thing or receive that thing. And I think that my journey has been and will continue to be ever changing, and I'm gonna want and have goals for certain different things, and I think the universe is gonna conspire around those goals to help me achieve them. And I think that that's what life is in general, and so I'm gonna go with that one.